with gross fraudsters who are determined to move assets quicker than you can freeze them. And there aren't so many of those cases, but they do happen. These days, cross-border enforcement is less of a problem because everybody, even people stuck in sanctioned countries, have their assets in such complicated networks that you can more or less always find some jurisdiction somewhere where you can enforce. So mostly, these days, arbitration awards and international court judgments are self-enforcing because the agony you can cause to an opponent who has assets on lots of different places if they don't comply is sufficient. Generally, they will comply. And then negotiations take place in the shadow of the law. In fact, then, once you've done with the enforcement phase, you then take out the judicial phase because you can predict what the judge will do, except on that basis anyway. So it's such an idea. I'll quickly mention sanctions because this colours my picture line. Sanctions, of course, we're lawyers, we know how to deal with sanctions because what's a sanction? It's a legislation and we know how to get around them, that's what we're paid to do. Sanctions colour what lawyers do, but virtually never make it impossible. The people who really make sanctions a nightmare are banks. Most sanctions are fairly easy to get around with a clever lawyer. The problem is that the banks won't have it. And it's not the text of the sanctions. Both sanctions, by the way, are drafted by politicians, not by lawyers. They're political documents. They're virtually impossible to understand. But they create a chilling effect on banks. And banks say, we're not going there. Hence Iran. Hence, the main effect on sanctions with Russia now is on the banks. It's the lending restrictions. That's how sanctions work. They block up banks. They don't block up lawyers, they just help us charge a little bit more in money. But then it's the banks that make them work. The bank, the sanctions we know are in place are those related to investments in the work in Crimea, certain government-backed energy in key sectors, then a spare bank in VTB and Gazprom Bank. That's where the sanctions have bitten. In Russia, and in energy, and in military. Military is not so effective, but it's banking. What Russian companies now can't get is loans. You can provide them with money and financing, you'll be popular. To some extent, we've had a few disputes arise out of people saying, well, I can't do this deal anymore because sanctions have stopped me. Those sorts of arguments sometimes work, but sometimes, but often don't. I'll just point that out to you. Mostly, sanctions themselves are not tailored in such restrictive ways that you simply can't get out of the deal. You can probably keep doing the deal, it's just going to become more difficult for you to do so. I give people lots of advice. They say, Matthew, we need a sanctions clause for our contracts. Yeah. I tell them, okay, we'll draft you one. But the problem with sanctions clauses is they almost always go to litigation because people try to withdraw from a contract after sanctions come into force. And then you could never draft a sanctions clause so effective and so comprehensive that it actually captured what actually in the end happened. Because what happens is that sanctions get drafted up by politicians in smoke-filled rooms at the last minute and imposed, and you think you know what they're going to do, and actually they are doing something different. Only your sanctions clause didn't capture it. Unless you offer sanctions clause along with the contract in itself, then it's going to be virtually impossible. With those few concluding remarks, because I know we're all already a little bit late, and listening to law for more than about half an hour, and unless you're a judge, tends to fray the finest of men's patience. I'm going to leave it there, and if any of you have any questions or comments about specifics and details, I'll be delighted to talk. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Matthew. Any questions for Matthew? Ruben? Unlike you to ask a question, Ruben. We're going to keep this one short and sweet, aren't you?
That's right.
I'm from. Imagine there are big companies in Russia who are still doing, although they are on your list, they do roadshow, they place notes, and money to them, how it is sort of related to sanctions. For example, Gazprom, I heard, raised some money, although Gazprom is on the list. So my question is, do big commodity companies have access to Western finance, even if they are in the list?
Those are two slightly different questions, but I'm going to try to blend them together into one answer. The sanctions restrictions on those three Russian banks prevent Western banks from engaging in long-term lending into them. So, I mean, the way Russian banks have traditionally worked is that they've been financed by European banks. And then in 1998, it all fell apart and everybody started arbitrating and litigating and then went through that again 10 years later and off we go. But there's no reason why, I say this is a lawyer's point. You can invest in Russia if you've got cash. You just have to structure it carefully. I mean, those banks have suffered because the restriction, remember, is on a Western bank, a European bank, from making a long-term lending commitment. But any of those banks have run away. But if you want to do business in Russia, you can find countless other ways to structure your investment that doesn't fall foul of those provisions.
So corporations have access?
Yes, fully. There's nothing stopping anybody doing any business with Russian companies. It's just the lending restriction. And everybody's going about their business. I mean, Russia's far too big a market just to be cut out. I mean, the sanctions have hurt, but they've hurt in unusual ways. They've hurt like the depreciation value of the ruble, because they've undermined a lot of confidence in the domestic banking system, as I understand this. It's things like this that have really caused Russia some economic damage, rather than the sanctions having the de facto effect of excluding large Western corporations from the Russian market. The Russian energy market is simply too important for large companies to be excluded or to run away from it.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Emeka Akapo. I'm a lawyer from Nigeria. The tendency is for English interests to glorify the English jurisdiction. Of course.
How can you not make any money otherwise?
Let's not do this.
But wouldn't you think that for the purposes of a choice of law jurisdiction, it would be more important to base that on the significant domicile of the transaction? Given that, if for instance, the transaction is going to be largely undertaken, say, in Nigeria, an enforcement of any dispute-related judgment will have to be done in Nigeria. Domiciling the jurisdiction in England may ultimately be UTOs.
I'm a believer in freedom of choice. There are some legal systems that are better, and there are some legal systems that are worse. And I don't have to sit here and preach to which the market can answer, given freedom of choice. People can write into their contracts whatever law they think is going to be the best and most effective in enforcing the deal they've done. Having said all of that, parties have different bargaining positions. I have seen many domestic laws written into long-term production sharing contracts over the insistence of multinational oil companies. That has happened because the country in question, the government has simply said, if you want that production sharing agreement, you're going to have our law in it, whether you like it or not. This sometimes produces some curious results, by the way. I once had a case where we had to work out what the law of the Democratic Republic of Congo was. And that was quite difficult because the country didn't have a commercial law, because it had been involved in a civil war for many years and its courts hadn't been operating. So sometimes I mean, I Nigeria is certainly not like that. Nigeria has a sophisticated legal system. But the problem you're always going to face in an international transaction is that people are going to say, we don't want hometown justice. We don't want the local courts because we think they might be, the perception is they might be biased against us. We don't want the local law because you, our counterparts, have more familiarity with that than we do. So we choose a neutral one. That's how the rise of these different sorts of commercial law, choices of law, took place.
I just want to follow on because I really stole the microphone from you. Isn't though, Matthew, the reality, I think what Emeka was really, if I understood it correctly, was really pointing at this idea of lex situs, you know, law in the place which the deal is being done. And I have a suspicion that if you have a dispute, for example, in, let's leave Nigeria for a second, shall we, Emeka, but let's go to Dubai, for example. You, in the end, if you want to take control of your collateral, if you want to take, you've got a customer that's in default, you're a lender, for example, you want to get possession, physical possession, of goods to the collateral, you actually have to submit yourself to Dubai law to get your hands on those goods. English law is of no value or use to you in Dubai. So I think, am I right, or maybe the distinction is, when we talk about English law, Emeka, I think we're saying this is the high seas stuff. I don't think this is trying to transpose English law into the domestic Nigerian